I'm wondering if there's a champion in the house this morning. Yeah. I'm looking for a champion in the house this morning. Yeah. I don't mean you're better than other people. I mean that you are a champion in who you are. Yes. You're a champion in standing on the word and what you believe.
Yes.
You're a champion because you're doing something.
Yes. Hallelujah.
God is looking for a champion.
Yes.
The world has his champions. But God is looking for his champions.
Yes.
Why is the question? Because this world, people are crying. People are dying. People are lonely. They're suffering. Children are starving. Does that touch you?
Yes.
Do you feel something?
Yes.
Oh, may God touch us this morning. Because the world is on fire. But there's also another fire burning, and it's the fire of the Holy Ghost.
Yes. Amen.
Yes.
And that's why we're Pentecostal.
Yes.
What does that mean? We speak in tongues. Oh, it's so much more than that.
Yes. Amen.
It's a surrendered life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And to become a champion, you gotta want it. I ask you this morning, what do you want?
Yes.
What is in your heart? What are you pressing for? What are you yearning for?
Right.
What is the drive of your heart to do, to become?
Yeah.
Or do you want nothing? Blessed are those who want nothing, for they shall not be disappointed. But do you have a drive? Do you have a passion? Do you have anything? I've never heard of a champion who said, oh, I'm a champion. How did that happen? Boy, it's a miracle. It just happened. Never happens that way.
Never.
You've got to want it.
Yes.
You've got to pay the price.
Yes.
You've got to endure the process.
Yes.
You've got to go against the negativity of 1,000 forces that come against you to become all that God wants you to be. You need a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. My wife, I called her Shinokans. And there was a time when I saw her from the distance and I heard about her. We heard about Jesus, but I wanted to know her. Never knew. And the Apostle Paul says, oh, that I might know him.
Yes.
And then later on he confessed, I know him whom I have believed. And when you know him, you get some persuasion down deep in your persuader, and to know him, yes, in the joy, but also the suffering. Number two, you need a heavenly direction. You are here on earth for a purpose. Everybody is here for a purpose. You are here for a purpose. There is something that God put within you that this generation needs.
Yes.
Do you know what it is that God put within you? I have a friend, he thought he was a tractor trailer trucking down the road, but it turns out he was a wheelbarrow. But God needs wheelbarrows. If you're a wheelbarrow, be the best wheelbarrow you can be. There are some times that you don't need a tractor trailer truck when you're moving cement, it's really concrete, from the mixer to the job site, you need a good wheelbarrow. But be whoever God has called you to be.
Yes.
And Isaiah, he was a good man, but you know, he needed a radical infusion of new lungs and new breath and new vision. And he saw the Lord high and lifted up. And that's what we're about as Pentecostal people. If we don't see the Lord high and lifted up, what are we doing?
There you go.
It's all about Jesus. Father, Son, Holy Spirit manifesting himself. So the Lord high and lifted up. And then he got this cleansing, deeper yet, a cleansing deeper. You'll never be the same again. And when you touch the Lord just once in your entire lifetime, you'll never be the same again.
Amen.
Number three, you got to deal with negativity. Be careful who you share your vision with. because there's some people who rain on your parade.
Yeah.
I remember when I went to Romania and I called somebody and they said, Roy, you're nuts. You don't speak the language, it's 5,000 miles away. What are you going to do? Invest all your money in some property over there? You're nuts. Now he's planning to come.
Yes.
Yeah, there you go. You got to deal with that stuff. You remember David and Saul, who you would think the king, seeing a courageous young man, would infuse some encouragement. But here's what Saul says. He says, you can't do this. And then he gives the reasons why you can't do this. And the devil will give you a ton of reasons why you can't do what God has called you to do. There's a long length of reasons. And if he doesn't appear himself in your spirit, there are people around you who'll tell you, you haven't been to theological seminary, you haven't had enough education, you're too big, you're too small, you're too skinny, or you're too, never mind. And always tell you why you can't do. And then to pull it off, he says, and look at the enemy. Look at Goliath. Oh, look how big he is. Look how strong he is. Look how experienced he is. You got to go against that stuff. If you want to change the world in some way, the world doesn't want to be changed until a champion comes along who will do something that's never been done before. And it ain't easy. But David just went out and he did it anyway. Then you got to have a testimony. You know, a lot of you folks, you've been through the war. You've been through some battles, emotional battles, spiritual battles, physical battles, financial battles. You got to go through the war because what did they say? Without a testimony, there's no, without, help me now. Thank you, Sister Kathy. Yes, without a test. So you've met the lion and you've met the bear. And you're still here because you've got a testimony. And then you can't give up. You remember the guy with the name, I remember it because I think of a church on a hill. And there he was, and when the Nazis were bombing the stuffing out of London, he got on the radio and he said, we're fighting France, fighting in the sea, ocean. Not with less and less confidence, with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We'll fight on the beaches, we'll fight on landing grounds and streets. We'll fight him and fight him and fight him, but we will never surrender.
Amen.
Never surrender. In his elegant British accent. The Lord tells us that, you know, don't weep out. You're not weary and well doing, for in due season, brothers and sisters, there is a due season.
Yes.
You know, sometimes the due season comes before the darkest of the night, when all hope is gone, when all hope is lost, when everything seems gone and lost, and then the dawn, oh, a scarlet flag unfurled, and it grew to be dawn's greatest lesson. Pray on, believe on, believe on, because we don't faint, we don't give up. Oh, I love that one here. You know, he's so close, and he gives up. You never know. And so I can encourage the couch potatoes to get up off that couch. Because we've got a ministry. Seeing, therefore, we have this ministry. And dear saints, if you're cooking skills, it's a ministry. If you're cleaning the church, it's a ministry. We're part of a team. Everybody does something. And you use the gift that God put inside you. Don't complain about what you don't have. Use what you do have. And so, I'm going to do my Rocky interpretation now, okay? You remember, what's his name, the big guy, you know, fighting against him, what is his name? Apollo, big, strong, mighty man. And he beat the stuffing out of Rocky. from corner to corner. He beat him up, and finally Rocky goes down on the canvas. This is my interpretation, you understand. And the referee goes, one, two, three. And on Rocky's corner, the manager goes out and says, Rocky, stay down. Stay down. He's too strong for you. He's too big for you. Play dead. Don't take any more punishment. Stay down. Now, I'm going to need your help. Help me to preach this, okay? Because when I go like that, it's your turn to shout, get up again. Okay? Let's practice.
Get up again.
A little bit more. More to it, okay? One, two, three.
Yeah.
Okay. And so the count was on. Four, five, six. He started to move. Can you see it? He started to move. He's trying to get up on his knees. Seven, eight, nine. He's up.
Get up.
Yes. And they nailed Jesus to the cross. They beat him. They put a crown of thorns on his head. They plucked out his beard. You think you're suffering? Just look at Jesus. You think you've got it hard? Look at the Apostle Paul. Sometimes the people with the greatest call go through the darkest night.
Amen.
It's part of the price.
Amen. That's good. Come on. Great word.
But it is a count of but the God of Romania, the God whom we serve, the God who's the God of the second chance, he comes and when Jesus comes, the tempter's power is broken. And after tragedy, I came whooping down here, sold my house, couldn't live in that house all by myself, kids were gone. And I came down here to live with my rescuers, my sister Carol and her husband Alan, and they took this poor homeless man out. I sold my house. They didn't take me out, they took me in. And I've been living with them ever since. And I used to be an ordained reverend, whatever you call them, with the Assemblies of God. But then I graduated to the Church of God. I became a bishop. Yeah. And then we went to Romania because the church brought a group to Romania. I was with Larry and Hope Crane there, amongst others. And there they asked me to preach. And I started to preach again. The oil started to flow again. And Jesus didn't say, stay where you are in your comfortable zone. You know, he said, get out and go someplace. It may be across the church pew, it may be across the block, it may be across to another nation, 5,000 miles away, but that's what we did. And we built that church for gypsies.
Hallelujah.
That team. And right here is your humble servant. I wasn't more slender there, I was taller there. For those of you on this side, that's me right here. And you know, my degree is in physics and mathematics, and I was a senior pastor of a church, 300. And when I got there, I got the job to take out nails from old lumber so they could reuse the lumber. You know, and there's my bucket, and there's my hammer removing the nails. And for those folks on this side, that's it. There's the bucket. And so when somebody complained, why do you sit down on the job?
Yeah.
Well, because I was more efficient that way. People work on the ground all the time. You know, I'm used to working on a table or a desk or something. But anyway, be that as it may, you know, in 2004, we bought this property. You know the story, the price was $5,000 until I heard it was in America, and then it was $6,000. We paid it anyway. I took my retirement from being an AG pastor. We bought this, and what do? Well, I was traveling out of my suitcase, sleeping in corridors and kitchens and every place. And I could do that for the rest of my life. And I said, God, help me with this. I could preach one church every weekend, different church, every weekend for the rest of my life. And you know how it is. How long do you remember one preacher's sermon? You know, an hour or before you get out of the church? Anyway, the Lord put it on my heart to start training. It doesn't mean we take them from scratch. No, they're educating the pastors normally, most of them. But then they have the church leaders. They have really no education. So we bring them to this place we call Apabia, and we train them. How do we do it? We do conferences. We bring in the youth. There's your good pastor there leading the band of five pastors doing ministry over there. We need help. It's too big for me. It's too big for any one man. It takes a team. It takes an effort. Why? Because we believe that whoever believes in Jesus Christ will not perish, but have everlasting life. Whoever believes in him, not whoever's perfect, whoever goes to church, gives money. No, whoever believes in him, two things happen. Will not perish. Number two, have everlasting life. It's that simple, that magnificent, that glorious.
Amen.
I heard you don't clean the fish until you got him in the boat. First you get him in the boat, then you clean him. That's what the church is all about. And so it's a team effort. There's my friend Jim Kerwin on the one side, and some other dear saints, Al Strickland and their team. And it takes a team. It takes a team effort. Yes, we don't have your Jason and Shelley and company, but we do the best we can with what we've got. And this one sister with a guitar can run the whole show. Just a gift. And so the Lord took me off the dunghill of despair and set me amongst princes.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It takes a lot of people sometimes to help us to
make it again.
It takes a lot of people to help us to
get up again.
It takes others sometimes. We need a hand, you know. Hey, can you give me a hand? Can you lift me up? They generally don't ask it that way, you know. You got to sense it and go to them and give it to them and so on. And my sister and brother-in-law, they did that. Your pastor did that to me. You know, he got me going again. And so we preach in churches, big and small. That church on the top there is where I found Schnookums. She's been there for 23 years waiting for me. And the smaller churches. And then God has opened Europe for us. Pastor, I would like to announce that you now have four campuses. And we are number four. Okay. Oh, we're number five. Okay, we're number five. Well, actually, we're number two in order of being. So on the website now, under another circle there, and it's called Kingdom Life Ministries Europe. Just as you best. This is where we've been. We're a launching pad. We're not a landing ground. We're a launching pad for men and women filled with the Holy Ghost who've got a burning desire in their heart. The red stars are where we've been. The gold stars are where we hope to be. And what now? We have a vision. Why? Because Islam is invading Europe. Islam is at war with the world.
Yes.
And I'm not talking about radical Islam. I'm talking about the those who truly believe what the Quran says. They're invading Europe, and their goal is to Islam rule the world. And they're coming in like a flood, and they're wanting to impose their Sharia law. Behead those who insult Muhammad and so on. Islam will dominate the world, and we're dealing with that in Romania. They want to build the largest mosque in Europe in Bucharest, Romania. And we're there. Why are we there? Well, I read someplace that when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will raise up a standard against him. And we don't preach against Islam. We preach Jesus Christ crucified and risen from the dead. They don't know Holy Ghost worship. They don't know the baptism in the Holy Ghost. They don't know assurance of salvation. They don't stand a chance against Holy Ghost ministry and the gospel of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. They don't stand a chance. And so there is where Islam has gained a significant root. The darker the color, the more significance. And you read that in the papers all the time. And they want to come into the United States. And how do they do it? By this, you know, so-called migration of immigrants and so on. Well, are they all bad? Well, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Just some of them have a radical agenda, and they don't mind using the sword to accomplish their agenda. That's what we're dealing with. And God put us there before this even began to happen. We're there for a purpose. And we need Holy Ghost ministry. We need Pastor Wooden.
Yes.
And God's looking for a few more champions. I don't want to mention anybody's name, Sister Candy, but, you know. Amen, Sister Sydney. Oh my God, raise up some Christian warriors, some champions who care, who are moved in prayer by the Holy Ghost to get a vision to become part of the move of God in the world today. Why should not Pentecost invade Europe and bring Europe back to Jesus Christ?
Amen.
And so this is our project. This is, I got fresh vision. I said, Lord, I don't want to do this year what I've done last year. Been there, done that, got the t-shirt, want to move on. And God gave me this insight that that's why we're there. So 2005, you see, your pastor was there with us from the beginning. 12 pastors, our first pastors conference. And that was our first general conference. In 2005, Sue Schlickens was there. She was after me and I didn't know her. And youth from this church, 18 came. Pastor Thurman, 2008, 30, 2010, 52, 2012, 72 pastors in the Wooden Lodge. Not because it's made out of wood, because it's the Randy Wooden Memorial Lodge. That's what it is. And we built it from 35 to 40. We got over 72 coming. And of course, here's a camp we did for kids and teens. We're doing something, folks. We're doing something, folks. I don't want to die in my bed. I want to die with my boots on about 45 years from now.
Amen.
And those are the four properties we own in the village where we live, Sapeștere. And the Abba means Abba in Romanian. And we got that last year. And this is it. And we're pouring footings there. There you can see the sticks if you can. The one here, one there, one over there, and one here someplace. And we're digging out the footings and are pouring in for a new multi-purpose building. Yeah. And there, about $125 will buy that truck full of sand. Then we need gravel. Then we need cement. Then we need a cement mixer. Then we need men with muscle, with desire.
Amen.
To accomplish something, to build something. If they want to build the biggest mosque in Bucharest, how about us building a nice building to teach men and women of God, the Word of God? Yes, and we can do it. And so here, that's my project. I've been trying to renovate that leaning tower there, that building. It was leaning, and I straightened it up. All the neighbors said, you can't build on that, it's leaning. I straightened it up. I took a come along with a chain, I tied it to a tree, and I pulled that come along until the building straightened up, and then I locked it in place. Amen. Don't complain about what you don't have. Use what you do have.
Yes.
And so we intend to build this stick. It's not exactly that, but something like that. What we'd like to accomplish this year is to build the frame, to build something like that on that piece of property. We will have a conference hall and a multi-purpose on the first floor and some apartments on the second floor. Can we do that?
Yes.
What do we have to do?
Yes.
Yes. In faith, we have to.
Yeah.
In love, we have to.
Yeah.
In giving, what do we have to do? We have to. Thank you. You're so good. Thank you, Lord. We figure we can erect the frame for about $15,000. Read this with me. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. Amen. We're there by the Spirit of the Lord. So, dear saints, we don't take collections in Romania. They give us things and so on. But, you know, it's a poor nation. So we depend on dear saints of God who love missions and who love KLM Europe.
Yes.
To do something for God. And I'm closing down here. Joshua, he was a champion. He did what he was called to do. The walls came tumbling down. He's dead. He's gone. Goliath and David. David was a champion. He fought. He died. He's gone. Gideon with his pitchers and trumpets. He did some great exploits for God. He's gone now. He was here. He's gone. John the Baptist, he didn't fit in with the culture. He didn't fit in with the cuisine. He didn't fit in with the runway models. But he did something for God. He's a champion, he's gone, the Apostle Paul. They beat him. They stoned him. They caned him. A night and a day on the deep. He wrote most of the New Testament from prison. And he had the right to say, "You, what are you complaining about? You haven't shed any blood yet." He says, he was a champion.
Yeah.
He's gone. He did, while he was here, he rose above the champion. Now, dear saints, I'm going to look and see if I got any champions here.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
I was in your class this morning for a few minutes, you know. I heard you. You're good. Yeah. Let me see. Oh, yeah, I see you there. Oh, yeah. Yeah. The chaplain for the man. Yeah, I see you, brother. I see you. Oh, where's the big guy? Where's the big guy? I greeted the big guy when he came in. Where's that big guy? No, he's huge. Big guy. Oh, there he is. Yeah, the big guy. Oh, yeah. Boy. Oh, do I see these? Pastor, I've got to stop now, but I wanted to announce to you that every one of us need to at some time, after we've been beaten down, we need to learn the lesson that we gotta
get out of here
and move on, because we're becoming champions.
Yes.
And you've got a house full of them. So let's decide, we dedicate with gratefulness. We are your humble servants. My name is Roy, and I'm your friend, and I'm married to Schnookums. Amen.